So, you have any questions? Yes? Yeah. At the moment, we kept the small b fixed, always under the assumption that small b, in the limit of the ground state, small b will survive anyway, because it's and in the limit of the Hoyle state, we suppose that the small b is always the size of the. But I will show you a view graph of the two-dimensional plot, then we can see how it goes. Yes.
My question is, from this phenomenon, you can say, okay, what a part alpha particle stay with the S wave from quantum mechanics in quantum mechanics. But from the experimental side, how can they decide whether they can cause condensation or not?
Well, experimental side is not so easy, yes. I will give you one experimental indication that at least the Hoyle state is 3 to 4 times larger volume than the ground state. But to have an indication like in superfluidity, like moment of inertia, these are still delicate questions which are still experimentally under study right now. So experimentally, to see something spectacular like reduction of the moment of inertia by some factors, such a strong point is not there for the moment. Sit down for a moment. So are we ready? This is okay, let's go on. Is it okay with the loudspeaker? Let's go on. There was a question. If we calculate the expectation value, we get, of course, an energy which depends on these two width parameters. And for the moment, in this effect on the antisymmetrization, we suppose that the small width parameter stays at the width of the free alpha particles. But in principle, of course, it depends, energy depends on the two width parameters. And here I show you a contour plot, a two-dimensional contour plot in the space of the two parameters. And there is a parameter R0, and these betas should be also R0, and R0b is related to R0 by b squared is small b squared plus 2R0 squared. So if R0 is 0, capital B is equal to small b, and so here at R0, for example, we have Slater determinant limit. Too loud? That's okay. Here's R0, and so here is essentially the limit. Here's B, and here's capital B, represented by R0. So if R0 is 0, you have here the Slater determinant limit. Small b larger, of course, larger than the alpha particle limit. But surface goes down, and very soon it goes over into a constant where the B is more or less 1.4, which is the size of the alpha particle. But you see also that from the Slater determinant limit, you gain some substantial energy due to alpha type, four-body type of correlations at the minimum here. And if you go, for example, to oxygen 16, the landscape gets more distorted. From around here to here, you gain about 6 MeV, which makes 5% of the ground state energy due in the ground state still to four-bodied alpha type of correlation. It is not a condensate. It's not a large volume where alpha particles can appear individually, say strongly overlap. One cannot talk anymore of alpha particles. But anyway, you see that soon for larger B values, you get for small B value the free space value which of the alpha particles, which is a constant. So let us go back to our picture. So we have a first indication that for the first excited zero plus state, the Pauli principle is not so dramatically important anymore, because we have here a value over 0.6, whereas the asymptotic value is 1. Whereas in the ground state, of course, the Pauli principle is very important. A more direct indication whether we have condensation or not of the three alpha particles are the so-called occupation numbers. What are the occupation numbers? Well, I explained that from the Fermi Dirac expression. You know that the occupations for Fermi or bosons as a function of I, or quite generally as an operator, you may write this as e to the h operator minus mu over t plus or minus 1. So this is an operator where h hat is kinetic energy plus some single particle potential. And now you can go into the into the representation where this is has some eigenfunctions, is equal to epsilon I. If you do that, you get immediately here your well-known Bose or Fermi distribution functions in terms of the epsilon i's. But you can also write this as in another representation, namely R1 R prime, which is equal to R I sum over I 1 over e to the epsilon I minus mu over t plus or minus 1. Again, I R prime. So this is a matrix which is not diagonal in R space. But if it so happens that you have this matrix in R space, you should diagonalize this occupation number representation, and you come back to this occupation numbers where you have the eigenvalues. Now, to get the eigenvalues of the occupations for the carbon 12 or Hoyle-Stedt, a little bit more complicated, you have to calculate the total density matrix of the wave function. Well, I erase all this. Just in short, the density matrix of the carbon 12 is R1, R up to 12, R1 prime up to R12 prime. This is a corresponding density matrix, but we want to get the single alpha particle occupancy. We our image is that the alpha particles occupy as a Bose condensate with the center of mass motion, also a bosonic mean field where the three alpha particles occupy the lowest state. So what we do, integrate out of this density matrix all coordinates up to the alpha center of mass coordinates R prime. So up to let's say the first alpha particle, we integrate out all coordinates, and then we stay with the single alpha density matrix, and we can diagonalize this density matrix. This can be done, it's a little bit complicated, but from the eigenvalues here, rho I, we can have a good estimate whether we are in the condensation or not. So we can do that for the ground state and for the Hoyle state, and we get the following picture. Now I'm going backward. I always go the wrong way. Okay, here are the occupation numbers. You see, this is the ground state. The ground state is distributed over the, it's only the even waves which are have occupancy. So the S wave, D wave and G wave more or less equally occupied. Whereas in the Hoyle state, you see, it's a huge dominance of the lowest state. So we are to over 70% here. This goes over 70% here for occupancy. I erased it again. If we have a mean field of harmonic oscillator type of 0s, three alpha particles in the 0s state, and then comes here a 0d and a 0g wave. So all the other occupancy here are at least by factor 10 lower than the occupancy of the Hoyle state. So with our relatively simple ansatz of the wave function, we get the picture of the Hoyle state that indeed the three alpha particles have the same 0s wave, center of mass wave function, to over 70%. Of course, as we have seen, the Pauli principle is not completely inactive. The Pauli principle scatters somehow the alpha particles also with some percentage in the higher levels, but the percentage is relatively weak, so that we can say the Hoyle state is to over 70% alpha particle condensate state. So when we published our work in PRL in 2001, we not only calculated carbon 12 because the wave function is relatively simple in quotation marks, we calculated also similar alpha condensate state in oxygen 16. For oxygen 16, this technique of Kamimura is out of the question, is too complicated, so nobody ever did Kamimura's calculation for anything higher than 3 alpha particles. With our wave function, we could do oxygen 16, neon 20, for heavier n alpha nuclei, because of the antisymmetration, which one has to do more or less by hand or by computer. It's not so much that the antisymmetrization, the many terms which you create, it creates huge differences of very small differences of huge numbers, and this makes the computational difficulties. So anyway, I will show you later calculations also for oxygen 16, and so forth and so on. Yeah, what did I want to say? The surprising point was now that we could take the overlap with the complicated wave function of Kamimura, these were the work of the Japanese people, squared overlap between Kamimura wave function and THSR wave function, squared overlap, it turned out to be practically 100%. It was always squared overlap, let's say 0.98. There are slight variants of the THSR wave function, so the overlap varies between practically 100% and say, let's say 0.95. So implicitly, our wave function and the wave function of Kamimura and also later Uegaki is the same wave function. So our wave function is, of course, first of all, technically much simpler because we have only 2 variational parameters. And also from the physical insight, we could calculate the degree of condensation of the 3 alpha particles. So when we published our work in 2001, our title was like Bose condensate state of the Hoyle state and oxygen 16. It made a lot of noise because it was some new feature in physics just a couple of years earlier. The Bose-Einstein condensation of the cold atoms was in coming up. This was a big story also, and so forth. So in the meantime, also our paper became rather famous, I must say. It is in the meantime cited about 500 times, which is for a nuclear physics paper relatively high story, high performance. So with the wave function we can, of course, now somebody asked the question whether one can see more directly, experimentally, that the Hoyle state is a condensate state of 3 bosons. Well, there is one indication. This is very difficult, but at least one indication we can mention is the following. This is the inelastic form factor. What is the inelastic form factor? It's essentially the Fourier transform of the transition density between the ground state and the density operator and the Hoyle state. Hoyle state Fourier transform. This is then what one calls the inelastic form factor, which depends not on R but on Q. And if you plot the inelastic form factor squared as a function of momentum transfer, that is what one calls is related to the inelastic excitation of the Hoyle state with inelastic electron scattering, EE prime, to the Hoyle state. So this is the form factor. This has a zero here because it must be orthogonal to the ground state. But you see that our theory with no adjustable parameters, I mean, I should mention that the Hamiltonian we used was adjusted by one of our collaborators, Tosaki, 15 years before we did our theory. So we had no free parameters, and our wave function and our theory reproduces the experimental values. So that this is not an accident comes from the following consideration. Of course, the wave function of Kamimura, since it's 100% practically the same as ours, also reproduce with the same quality this inelastic form factor. Now, what is, besides the fact that is this an accident or is this not an accident? Let us see whether we can find something. Where is it? Here. These are all the experimental values of the inelastic form factor from the ground state to the Hoyle state. But in the meantime, the new graph which I've seen in Darmstadt, more points have been measured, and this gives rise. This, by the way, is the elastic form factor. And you see that this THSR wave function also can reproduce quite well the ground state. So because then the capital B parameter is more or less equal to the small b parameter, and we have a Slater determinant, as we discussed. And so ground state is also quite well reproduced. But the point I want to make here is that in our calculation, we can put the Hoyle state, vary the radius of the Hoyle state artificially. And here is the form factor squared, which goes into the cross section, as a function of the difference with respect to the nominal value of the radius of the Hoyle state. So we see here that if we make the Hoyle state 20% larger, this gives a factor of 2 variation of, for example, the first maximum. So the shape doesn't change anymore, but I mean, on the logarithmic scale here, you won't see it very much, but a 20% change of the radius of the alpha gas state makes a factor 2 of difference in the cross section, and this is a huge variation. And since we reproduce the inelastic form factor without any adjustable parameter, this made us believe very much that at least the fact that the Hoyle state has a volume 3 to 4 times larger than the ground state is a reality. And since the volume is large, alpha particles have space to get borne out, and the assumption that this large volume alpha particle gas state is a condensate state is relatively suggestive. So let me come back to, yes, maybe you've seen this. Yes. Well, and that this is in a certain way similar to the alpha condensation of cold atoms. We have I told you already, where is it? Just as a reminder. Wait, I don't find it anymore. Yes, it must come here. Again, condensation phenomena, quantum condensation phenomena are macroscopic manifestation of quantum physics. Superconductivity and superfluidity is a macroscopic manifestation of quantum physics. Condensation phenomena are one of the most spectacular quantum phenomena. As I told you here, these peaks are just n times the ground state density magnified. So in a boson, you have in the Hardy term n times the phi zero of r squared. And in cold atoms, like here, it's maybe 100,000 or billion of atoms. So this gets magnified. And this is almost, you almost can see this with the naked eyes. So this is a density, which is maybe some microns or I don't know what. At the end, they switch off the trap and then expands and make such photographs. But some are almost as big that you can see it with the naked eyes, some almost millimeter. Size. So, of course, the Hoyle state is far from such a thing, only 3, or in oxygen 4, but nevertheless, the physics is relatively similar. So, let me come. There was a question about the third zero plus state in carbon 12. Let me come to the following. I don't dwell on this very much, but what is the situation now? I am going backward again. Here. Now it's better, I have a better view. Well, the point is, as I told you, a usual nuclear shell model approach where one diagonalizes huge matrices for the carbon 12. Following answer. You have here good reproduction of certain states. This is experiment. You see very good reproduction of the first 2 plus state, of the 1 plus state, 4 plus state, and so on. This is of the dimension of the matrix. Whereas 3 states are completely out of the spectrum. And one of the 3 states is the Hoyle state. Third zero plus state, and the second 2 plus state. So they're completely out. They are, in these calculations, they come at maybe 30 or 20 MeV high. So no way to get these states. Let us see how we interpret these states now with this THSR wave function. Do I go forward or backward? Yes, I go forward. No, I go again backward. I don't have to. By the way, of course, with THSR wave function, you can also calculate the beryllium 8. As I told you, beryllium 8 is deformed, and you have a rotational spectrum. You very well reproduce also the rotational spectrum of the beryllium 8. The 4 plus state is unstable, so it's a relatively large ridge. This is this head. Are going backward again, yes. There's another picture of this occupancies. Well, same picture. Now here comes our interpretation from this THSR wave function of these three states which could cannot be reproduced with the most modern shell what one calls no core shell model calculations. Of course, we have seen that the Hoyle state here to over 70% is such a state where the alpha particles seen as ideal bosons are condensed in the lowest state of a harmonic oscillator. We interpret the second 2+ state, which was also not reproduced by the shell model calculation, as a lifting of one alpha particle in the zero D state. So naturally D is L equals 2, so you have a 2+ state. And the third 0+ state, we think it is a higher nodal S wave state. So it's a one alpha particle lifted into the 1S state, which has one node instead of the 0S state. So this is a very nice interpretation of these missing three and three states in the spectrum of carbon 12. And nowadays people say the in some sense the Hoyle state is the ground state of the three alpha gas state, and on top of this ground state you have several alpha excited alpha gas states. So in a way one can say that in carbon 12 there is a coexistence of the fermionic picture. Ground state is more or less a fermion gas, and if you go a little bit higher up in energy, around between 7 and 10 MeV, you have bosonic ingredients, namely the alpha particles, and they form a bosonic state, bosonic spectrum. And the occupancy of the bosons is 0.7 or a little bit higher. But the fermions in the ground state also have not 100% occupancy. People measured occupancies of the fermions. I showed it's the ideal Slater determinant occupancy, 1 or 0. In reality, by knockout reactions, one sees that the fermions also occupy maybe 0.8 only or 0.7. So the occupancies of the fermions and the bosons more or less similar. Okay, what? Yes. 1- Fourier state. Yes, yes, yes. Translational, total translational state. Yeah. What else to say? Yes, let's come to oxygen 16. Oxygen 16. Yes, please. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, this is a good question. This is a little bit complicated. Actually, to calculate, for example, the 2+ state, you must allow THSR wave function to be deformed. So it's easily achieved to get a deformed THSR wave function, because if the exponent is minus r squared over b squared, or 2r squared over b squared, if you have a deformed system, you can say this is 2rx squared over bx squared e to the minus plus ry squared over by squared, and so forth and so on. So this, at least in the center of mass motion of the alpha particles, this gives a deformed state. So a deformed state is some sort of superposition of many good states with good angular momentum, and then you can project out the state with good angular momentum from this deformed state, very quickly speaking, and then you can get the wave function of the 2 plus state in this way. You have to project it on good angular momentum, and then you can analyze, and we did that. Actually, yes, I should mention one important thing from our collaborators. After we published this paper, maybe 2 years later, we had two new collaborators, which are Yasuro Funaki, which made his thesis with us, and Taichi Yamada from Yokohama University, which was already a professor there. And these regulations, for instance, have this view graph has been prepared by Funaki, who is now also a senior scientist. And he also then interpreted the second 2 plus state in such a simple way from his calculations, that it's just a lifting of one alpha particle into the D wave state. So this is a very natural outcome here, and interpretation of this triplet of states. Also the fact that this third 0 plus state has a very large width gets its nice explanation, because a S wave has no centrifugal barrier, so it can decay very easily, whereas a 2 plus state has a centrifugal barrier, so it's more stable. And all these states, if we calculate the radius, has a very extended radius with respect to the ground state. Okay, let us come to oxygen 16. Oxygen 16, 4 alpha particles. So things get more complicated. So instead of a product of 3 alphas, we have product of 4 alphas. But the essence of the calculation is the same. But in oxygen 16, the situation with the clusters is considerably more complicated. In carbon 12, you have a ground state, but if you knock loose one alpha particle, you remain with beryllium 8. And beryllium 8 itself is a loosely bound alpha particle state, as I have shown you. It's already a chain state. Whereas in oxygen 16, if you out of the ground state one alpha particle, you remain carbon 12. And carbon 12 can be in some excited state, first to plus state, other state. So we have done a calculation with THSR wave function. Actually, THSR wave function is not very adapted to, unless one makes some generalization, to explain the full 0 plus spectrum of carbon 12. So Yamada, who is a specialist on this orthonormal condition model, which is a phenomenological model, made a huge calculation to explain this 0 plus spectrum together with Funaki of oxygen 16. And I show you the spectrum. Well, I have a nicer view graph than this one. Somewhere it should come. No. Here. This is the spectrum, 0 plus spectrum of oxygen 16. This is the ground state experimentally. First excited state at about 6 MeV. It's a well known state since long time. 6.06 MeV, 0 plus state. Next 0 plus state, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. The alpha particle THSR only gives 4 states because of the deficiency, as I just told you, that we treat all alpha particles on a democratic footing. So eventually only one state which has a 4-alpha particle condensate can be correctly reproduced, and maybe the ground state, as we have seen also for carbon, the ground state is well reproduced. So maybe the highest state and the lowest state in THSR is well reproduced. The highest state is, of course, again, the alpha particle condensate state. It should be identified with the 6-0-plus state in the spectrum of oxygen 16. The two other states in the spectrum are something like alpha particle is moving around the ground state of carbon 12. Here it's alpha particle is moving around in an S wave of the ground state of carbon 12. Here alpha particle is moving in a higher nodal S wave. Here alpha particle is moving around the D wave in the first excited 2-plus state to get the 0-plus state and so forth and so on. This is now an extended OCM calculation in a huge dimension, which has been done by Yamada and Funaki. And they reproduce up to small differences, which in view of the complexity of the calculations is a very nice reproduction of the whole first 6-0-plus states. Good reproduction of the whole spectrum. So the analysis of this calculation here shows that only the 6-0-plus state can be identified as an alpha condensate state. And this is shown in some wave function. Yes, this is not yet the wave function. These are again the occupation numbers. So here are the occupation numbers maybe of the 5th 0-plus state, quite distributed occupation numbers of alpha particle around ground state of carbon 12. These are the different carbon 12 states. All the others lower states of the 6-0-plus states have similar distributions, whereas the 6th state again has a huge overlap with the Hoyle state plus alpha particles. You can imagine that you have the carbon 12 in the Hoyle state plus an alpha particle, so this gives a 4-alpha particle state loosely bound, and you see that the 6th state is has a huge overlap with this configuration. So in this interpretation, the 6th state is the alpha particle condensate state, which is actually at 15.1 MeV. 15.1 MeV, the 6-0-plus state in oxygen 16. The oxygen, this state is maybe 700 MeV above the alpha threshold. So it's like the Hoyle state, like beryllium 8, slightly in the continuum. Actually, about the Hoyle state, I forgot to tell you one thing. I told you that beryllium 8 has a width of 1 eV because of the strong barrier. The Hoyle state also has a width of 1 eV only. So it's not a stable state, but it's a very long-lived state on nuclear scales. This and the Hoyle state is about 300 kV of the 3-alpha threshold. Here in oxygen, this 6th state has some similarity with the Hoyle state because it's 700 kV above the 4-alpha threshold, but has already quite a sensible decay. It's 150 kV broad. But for a state which is 115 MeV, KV width is quite small, and we interpret this smallness of the width by the fact that all states below have a quite different configuration than just a gas of 4-alpha particles, so there is no probability to decay. Of course, as we have seen, even in the ground state there are some correlations of 4-alpha particle type of correlations, and so there is some percentage where this state can decay into the ground state. So let us see the wave function. The wave function should be in the next view graph. Yeah, you see, this is the wave function. This is the wave function. It's hard to see. Yeah, this blue one is the ground state. You see, has a, because of the Pauli principle, has a strong nodal structure, whereas the sixth state has a very wide distribution, something like a Gaussian. So it's a Gaussian of the alpha particle, which has a, again a very large radius with respect again of this order of four times the volume of the ground state of the Earth. So this is actually at the moment a very hot topic also from the experimental side to identify this 6-0 plus state in oxygen 16 as an analog state to the Hoyle state. Unfortunately, there exists no inelastic form factor. This state has been identified with inelastic electron scattering also at 15.1 MeV, but the inelastic form factor has not been measured. So we cannot compare, as was the case for the Hoyle state, our calculation with experiment. And so the interpretation or the confirmation that this 6-0 plus state has a large extension is still missing, but experimenters are heavily working also to find other ways to get a handle on the extension of this Hoyle state, namely from inelastic alpha scattering and so forth. One can also indirectly get how big this state is. What else to tell you? Maybe I stop here, then tomorrow we still have to discuss another way of tackling and handling alpha particle correlations, which is based on the so-called Brink wave function. But we will see that there are strong differences between the THSR wave function and the Brink wave function, and we will see that tomorrow. Okay.